This video is intended as an overview of the new features of Krakatoa 1.6, as well as some existing features that have been around for a while. Let's open an existing scene with just a single geometry object on it. This is the Stanford University scan of the Buddha statue. We're going to use this geometry object as a source of our particles. In Krakatoa 1.6, in addition to the customizable icons that used to ship in previous versions, we also have a Krakatoa menu which exposes exactly the same features. For example, assigning Krakatoa as the current renderer, creating particle volumes and particle loaders, and so on. Let's click the Create PRT Volume object from selected objects. And now we have a particle system, which represents the volume of the geometry that we used to have previously. The object itself, the original mesh, has been switched to bounding box display in order not to be in the way, and it has also been set to non-renderable, so it doesn't accidentally get rendered in Krakatoa or in another renderer. Currently, the distribution of the particles is set by default to jittered. We're going to disable this one, and this gives us a grid of particles. Currently in the viewport we have 5,000 particles, but note that the spacing for the rendering is about 4 times more dense, so we're going to create a lot more particles. Next, we enable the Krakatoa renderer. We assign it using the default settings, and if we would hit the render button at this point, nothing really would happen. Looking at the alpha channel, we see that they are particles, and according to the display, they are about 350,000 particles there, but they don't render in the RGB channel. In addition, since we are running the evaluation mode that anybody can run by downloading the Krakatoa version from the Prime Focus website, we're also getting a watermark on top of the image. Let's fix those two things. First, we'll switch the resolution to 480, which is the standard low resolution of YouTube, and at this point rendering would give us no watermark. That means you can produce 480 by 360 images or animations with the free version of Krakatoa without paying anything. And the other thing that we have to figure out is where are our particles. If we would click on the Krakatoa schematic flow, which is also exposed at the bottom of the main controls of the UI, we get a display of all the basic modules of the renderer, including the sources in the scene and the different stages the particles would pass through while being processed before ending up in the frame buffer. We see that one of those modules, the render particles, is displayed in red, and it says that the particles will render black RGB unless there is at least one light in the scene or we enable self-illumination through checking the use emission option. There is a quick way to fix this by just right-clicking the sort for lights node and selecting create default spotlight. This creates one spotlight in the scene that is going to illuminate our particles, and if we would hit the render button again, we're going to get some illumination. Now our particles are distributed in a grid, and obviously the density that we're getting is not enough to fill up all the pixels that we have scheduled for rendering. So we're going to do two things. First, we'll select the PRT volume object and subdivide the voxels that were created from the geometry, which will give us significantly more particles. And we'll also reduce the per particle density in order to avoid getting very solid rendering. If we would hit the render button again, in the alpha channel we'll see that our particles are accumulating nicely and are almost semi-transparent in areas, and if we look at the RGB it's relatively smooth. We don't see any rows and columns from the distribution of particles in the volume. We can go even lower with the density per particle. This lets more light penetrate through the statue. And since we have too much shadow here, one way to fight this would be to enable the emission and set some emission color that we want to use as a kind of ambient lighting. Note that in version 1.6 there is an emission strength spinner, which should be typically set to the same value as the density, otherwise we would get too much self-illumination, too bright self-illumination. This is also a lot, so we can reduce it to half the value of the per particle density, and we're getting a relatively nice semi-translucent looking statue lit by a single light. Another thing that we could do, of course, would be to clone the light that we already have. Let's take a look at the light in one of the viewports. We could zoom a little bit in with this light and then select it and shift move around to create a secondary light source, change its multiplier to about 0.5, change its color to something bluish, and looking in the front view, move it a little bit down. At this point, we could reopen the virtual frame buffer, disable the emission, and take a look at the rendering of 2.8 million particles lit by two lights, one white and one slightly bluish. Since our particles are by default yellow with the same color as the object that we started with, we're not really seeing much of the blue color here, but we could enable the override of the particle color, set it to white, and take a look at the actual illumination of white particles. Now we can see white color source from the left and bluish color source from the right. Another thing that we could enable is the absorption. We can check the use absorption option and then override the absorption. If it would render the way it is right now, not much would change, since the absorption is set to black, and that means no color will be really affected. If we would click the color swatch and set it, for example, to absorb mostly the red color from the light penetrating the object, the result would be the inverse. Instead of getting a red statue, we're actually getting a blue statue. And if we would take a look at the actual Krakatoa global render values, we have a set of two color pickers. One defines what color will be affected by the absorption, and the other one defines what color we will get from white particles when that absorption is applied. So for example, if we want to get a really, let's say, violet result, we can set the second color picker to that value, and if we would render, the statue will turn into the color that we just requested. A short note about the advanced controls in the virtual frame buffer. It is important to note that they are disabled by default and have to be specifically enabled in the Krakatoa preferences by checking the load VFB extensions on startup option and then restarting 3ds Max. After that, most of the main controls found in the Krakatoa user interface can be actually accessed quickly through the expanded panels on top and at the bottom of the virtual frame buffer.